Let me see who here. We might have a little special guest for you. Let me pause this 1 second. See, is that you?
Can't buy you love. Can't buy you love. Can't buy you happiness.
See, there you go. Always try to steal something. You always got to be in the lead. Yeah. What's up, Boogie?
Yeah. What's good in the hood, Cambridge? Hey, they can't tell us what we can't do now. This is your show. They can't tell us what we can't do
that's
now.
Right. You can't tell us what we can't do now.
Yeah, I told you. You better to own.
So look, man, it took me to bring Ralph to get you on here. I've been inviting you on here for years, and you ain't came yet.
Man, come on, man. You know I was coming. I told you. Let me know when. I'm trying to run for president.
Oh, Lord, please don't. Please don't. We got it bad enough as it is, man.
You might want me more than you want Kanye. Be careful.
Hey, behave yourself, boy. Behave yourself. Ladies man. And gentlemen, my brother Boogie right here. Boogie, man, I love you, boy.
Man, I love you too. What a special day this is, man. I'm excited. I'm going to sit back and watch y'all and watch Ralph do his thing. All mine. It's out. It's here. I can't even tell you how much we waited for this day. So this is pretty awesome. Pretty awesome, man. So, hey, I just wanted to tap in.
Rocking with this song, Johnny? How long ago did you send me this song?
Oh, my God. At least, over a year, maybe a year and some change. Because remember I sent it to you as soon as we finished it up. And I was like, what'd you think? Yep. He was like, yo, that's a hit there.
And that thing is fire, boy. I remember the version that wasn't even mixed yet. So yep, Ralph is standing by, man. So you go ahead and introduce Ralph, and then we're going to get him in here, and then me and you will talk later.
Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, here he is, the man himself, Mr. Sensitivity. And now we're talking about, for the grown folks, All Mine. I'm talking about this is the one and only, my brother, Mr. Ralph Tresvant. Y'all give it up. I'm going to sit back, and I'm watching this.
Yes, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, Boogie. Thank you, boy. Hit that intro, and let's get Ralph up in here. See, that's why y'all got to hang with me. That's why you got to know me. I know people that you love.
Hey y'all, let me talk to you, man. What's up, man? Hey, G, what an intro, big boy. Hey, man. Propane, what's up, man?
Rizz is here, ladies and gentlemen.
Rizz
is here.
Put your
hearts up.
We're in the building, man. We said it was going to happen. We're here.
Right now, put your hands
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Boy, what's up, Knife Wonder? Knife Wonder in the house. What up, Rizz?
How you feeling, man? You looking great, bro. Oh, as always, you, man.
You too, man. You too. You looking good, boy. See, we age gracefully.
I'm feeling good, man. I'm feeling good. We got a lot of special things going on right now. And so, you know, it's a good time to be me, man. I can't complain.
Man, it seemed like it'd been so long since I seen you. But you know what's funny? The very last concert that I went to see you and Johnny at the MGM National Harbor. I didn't see you because I didn't get a chance to speak to you. I saw you by people showing me pictures. But, man, I had no idea we was going to get locked down right after that. That was the last concert I went to.
Wow, that's crazy. Yeah, we got locked right after that. That's right.
Yeah.
That's us, man. Well, you know. We still out here, man. I wish that was what's one of the things I know I'm going to miss with launching this new album, you know, this new project and stuff. Yeah. Just being able to move around and touch the people, and you know, that's one of my specialties. Something I love to do the most is just sit around and talk to people and feel their vibe, take pictures, and you know, kick it with fans and stuff, man. That's one of my favorite things to do. So, you know, but we're gonna get it done regardless, man. You know, we're gonna make it happen.
Absolutely, man. Ooh. I've been looking forward to this too, Ralph, man. Because Johnny sent me that song a while back, and I saw that smash right there, boy. That's a hit. And you know, I'm happy to hear that you're back, man. So, you know,
you got it before it was unmixed, right? You got it before it was even. We just got it hot off the press. Yeah, we was just finished recording. We sent it to you. That's right. He told me you dug it. Mm-hmm. That's a good hit. So, you know, we've been trying for a minute, man. You pushed some of my projects. You know, they didn't do what we wanted to do, but you always made sure I had a home for them, man, to see. Man. So, mad love to you, Cayman, for always being there for me, man, in the real world. I appreciate that, fam.
No doubt, man. You know you're my brother, man. We got to look out for each other. Ain't nobody else going to do it. You know what I mean? So look, Ralph, you mentioned that project. That was 2005, bro?
Yeah, it was. 2005, man. That was the last time I moved around. It was a while ago, man. You know, I was talking with some of the fans. Some of the riders was posting it for me. It was like, man, it's been almost 15 years or something like that since I dropped the joint, and 30 years since Sensitivity. And I couldn't believe that. That was just aged me. Yeah, aged me overnight. As soon as I heard that, man, I got two more grills in the beer. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what took so long? What are you doing in a 15? I mean, I know I've seen you, but, you know, just for the sake of asking the question, what are you doing in a 15-year period when you're an artist? You're not putting out any music. What's going on with you?
Raising my kids, you know, being a dad, family man, just kind of, you know, regular thing, enjoying doing that for a while. It had been a while before them 15 years of just being a New Edition member, doing, you know, the Sensitivity Project, just being an artist. So I was just enjoying just being off and having fun with the family and watching them grow, getting them where they needed to go, you know, as far as my kids are concerned.
Yeah.
I got grandkids now, man, so just watching them. And real talk, I got three grandchildren. Shout out to Zayel, Christian, and Noah, man. You know, Quell and Darius are doing the thing. My babies have been raising them very well. So
at the end of the day,
man, just doing that, you know, the regular life thing, man, and getting back to that in a real way. So now after everybody's kind of grown and out doing their own thing, it's like, all right, what you going to do? So, you know, I got to stand up on it. Got to get back up off it, man, and jump on this throne a little bit.
Yeah.
Get back in the game, man.
What's your grandkids call you, Ralph?
And he was still moving around, so I was staying busy doing things with them. Johnny launched a project in between that we did this for me and you. We did a couple of tours and stuff like that, so I stayed active. We did a little Heads of State move with me, Bobby, and Johnny. We were moving around, still just doing things, but as a solo artist, I had just been putting everything on the back burner and just getting in here and there on these little projects with everybody else. So
yeah,
I'm gonna get back to my own thing, man.
But you know what, man, and you've never been really like a selfish type of guy. I mean, even when you were younger, as much as you was holding New Edition together, you shelved your project early on, you know, so those guys could still eat. So, you know, I mean, I applaud you for being the man that you are and being able to look out for everybody else that you came up with. Let me give you a round of applause, bro.
The cards was dealt that way for me, man. You know, I was raised that way. To stick with the roots helps, you know, that's what we started out with. So I wanted to try to make sure I did all I could do to get it where it was supposed to go, you know, optimize the New Edition movement and all of that stuff. So it was always about that first to me. And then whatever I can do as an individual in between, you know, if time permitted, that's what I did. But now it's like, what, you done got the Hollywood Walk of Fame, you done got the life story told about the group, you done did all these things now, so
yeah.
What else do you do? More tours, more records, that's obvious, so let me go out here and expand on these opportunities that's still available for me right now and see what I could do to secure my own bag, my own legacy, and all that, see what I can do, you know?
Man, you know what's funny, now that you mentioned that, because we talked about some of these things that came to fruition, we was talking about this stuff years ago.
We sure did.
Years. We talked about the movie. We talked about, you know, the whole life story, the Hollywood Walk of Fame. And we've been able to see all of this stuff come to fruition, man. That's beautiful, bro.
Man, they were successful, man. You know, that movie did very well. So
The
time, everything was perfect, man. You know, it's all in God's time. And we can't rush what's not in his time. And you know what I mean? At the end of the day, it could have probably been something that was whack. We didn't want a lifestyle. What is it? Whatever that thing is, one of them life channels, whatever that was.
What's that movie? It's the Lifetime channel.
John, we didn't want to do that with the Frank wigs and the actors that don't look like you and can't really perform the part, right? Yeah, we didn't want none of that pop in. So the blessing was that everybody's alive to go ahead and be a part of the story and make sure it was told right, you know, and make sure they had the right person playing them and all that stuff. We were all involved from the rooter to the tutor with that project. So it's a blessing that, like you said, it was probably 15, 16 years in the making from the time we actually spoken to people about it. But prior to that, like you and I had already told, when we going to do the story, when you going to do the NE joint, man, and get y'all out, you know, tell people how it already went down. Mm-hmm. And so, like we said, it's all in his timing, man. We just got to rock when he's ready. Be ready when he, you know, when the time and when the doors open up, we got to be ready to step through them. So yeah, we were, and the fans was right there waiting on it. The anticipation for it was perfect. The home we did it in with BET, that was a perfect place to do everything. So it lined up well.
No, absolutely, man. I was so proud to be a part of that too, man. Being out in L.A. when y'all put that star and unveiled that star on the sidewalk. I've been walking past it. Every time I go to L.A., I got to go see it.
My man, that's what I'm saying. You know, I haven't seen it since we've dropped it down. I haven't been nowhere near the stars since it's been down there, man. I've been living vicariously through everybody else taking photos, and some of the family will come down and they ask me what street it's on, that kind of stuff. I'll tell them where to go. But I haven't been back down there. I got to go down there and do a special shot standing by the star just for my own records. You know?
You ought to go out there and sit in the middle of the sidewalk. Sit on that star, boy. You worked hard.
I'm going to camp out and fall asleep there one day. I'm going to put a tent up. From Adams Street and Roxbury to Hollywood Boulevard, man. Right. Whoever thought it was going down, you know. Something you pray for, but it's real.
Yeah.
You know, next stop, we get that Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, John. We're going to go get that next, too.
Yeah, man. Talking into fruition, man. You know, we talked about it and it happened. You know what I mean?
Yep. So absolutely.
Look, let me ask you this, man. Do you ever sit back and just be in awe of the things that you've been able to accomplish and still be relevant to this very day? Because, I mean, you was a kid when this thing started. Did you think it would go this long?
You know, you never know. You pray it. When we sat down, that's just one of the things we wanted to stick around, like we saw the Isley Brothers and all of the bands before. So Fire, Frankie Beverly and Mays, these are some of the cats, even the Jacksons, Temptations. We watched how they went down and history with it all. It seemed like they just had a time. There was no timeline on when they was going to be done with it. It's just as long as they was alive, they was going to be up and rocking. So we kind of took that same formula at heart and always kind of leaned toward that as a group. We moving around. It's like we plan on being here. This is what we do. We started as kids. We spent all of our younger days missing all of the other opportunities we probably would have jumped on as kids to, you know, bag and feed our family. So this became it. After a while, it's like, hey, this is all we got. We better make sure this lasts until the wheels fall off. So that's what's been the goal. You know, again, you never know what's going to happen. But yeah, I tell you, one of the big motivators and motivations is those fans. That fan base, when you going to do something else? We waiting for another project. Are we waiting? All that kind of stuff is what drives you to get up and say, all right, let's do another one. They want it. Let's give it to them. You know, I think if they'd have shut down years ago and went on to something else and wasn't checking for the group no more, we'd probably left it alone a long time ago. The fact that they've been there just always inviting new projects and looking for us to push and do something else, that drives you to get back in the studio, get back in the gym, get back in the, you know, the rehearsal studios and start working on reality. It gets you back up and, you know, that's what keeps you motivated. So shout out to the fans, the New Edition fans who are like none on the planet, and the Rizz Riders, man. My particular fans, man, I don't know where I'd be without them, man. They are everything, K-Man. I'm telling you, man.
I know it. They in the house, boy. I've been seeing them all day.
Yeah, they've been telling me about it. So Cayman been keeping it popping all day. He's been letting everybody know what's coming. He's pumping a hard body for you. I was like, yes, that's my man.
Man, let him know we go way back like babies and pacifiers, boy.
Exactly, man. That's what I told him. I told him that on the preview, on the thing, the promo for it. I let him know this is my man's. We go all the way back. And you know, again, like I said, always supporting not just me, but all the individual projects, the New Edition project. And you know, in particular me, man, just the way you've always reached out to me and had a home and a place for me, man, when I was dropping stuff, I always felt attached to you for that, man. So, you know, my brother for life, man, that's what it is. And, you know, you ever need anything, you know, you can call on me. I don't care what's going on with the game. I'm shutting it down for Cayman. I got to go be a part of what he's doing. It's my man.
I appreciate you, man. You already know. You already know that. So, look, let me ask you this too, Ralph. You know, because we got to take it back, because I know we had some great conversations about this music. Even you coming up in the solo, and everybody knows the New Edition story now and how that voice was picked out to be the lead of New Edition. So when you went solo and BBD had already come out, Bobby was doing his thing. Talk about how you got placed in the lane of the Stone Cold Gentleman and the Man with the Sensitivity and all that stuff.
It was crazy, man, because that was never the lane. When I was working on the album that you know never came out, the Living in a Dream album, that album was full of swing. It was full of Around the Way, where I grew up at, and what I was driving. I just got a Porsche. I had a song on it called My Porsche. Another one called I Could Do This. I was just flamboyant. I was moving a whole nother direction, like coming out of Orchard Park. I was representing OP, you know, to the fullest. So my thing was to come that way. And as I got down to Minneapolis, and you get down to Atlanta where Facing Them was, you know, it's just these guys are just vibing with you and checking out your steed and how you get down.
Yeah.
And so that's how those records come about. Next thing I know, there's a song from Jimmy and them was reflecting what they see in me. And that was sensitivity, to do what I gotta do's. Those kind of records started coming out of just them seeing my personality and vibing with me. Stone Cold Gentleman came from Daryl and KO, LA and Babyface. That's the vibe they got from me. You know, this dude's Stone Cold, but he's a gentleman about it all. You know, I get high, you know, so they put it together in a song fashion, in a form of a song. And we went in there and cut the joint, man. It was one of those things that those songs came about because of every, you know, their perspective of who I was. You know, that wasn't something I would have never went in and said, yeah, let's do sensitivity. I want to show my sensitivity. That's what I'm about. I was nowhere near that at the time, far as I was concerned. But I guess my demeanor, my actual real personality and all that stuff, once he was around me, that's what I was giving off more than I thought I was giving off, the cool cat from around the way that, you know, all that. I wasn't really that for real, I guess. You know, right. The main thing, portions of that, but what was really standing out to them was the records that they ended up writing about me. So I always appreciate when I heard them. I was like, yeah, that's right. I'm Stone Cold and I'm a gentleman. I like that. Let's rock with that. Since when I first heard that, I was crazy. Listen to them chord progressions. Listen to them harmonies. This is going to be crazy. I got it. That's me. And you know, my thing with Jimmy and Terry was to let them do what they do. I was just already a huge fan like everybody else. I watched how they transformed Janet into what they did her into, and Sherelle and Alexander O'Neal and all this stuff. And I'm like, you know what? I'm not trying to get in the way. Whatever you see, let me go ahead and just record that and get it down on wax. So that's how I ended up rocking with them. I just let them do what they wanted to do with my voice. And they taught me a lot about how to use my voice, how to better what I'm doing and stay in my lane, find my own lane and all that kind of stuff coming out of the New Edition stuff. Like, what was I really going to be able to hit the public with that represented something I could stand by and repeat night after night in concerts and things like that? So it just became one of those real situations where I was learning who I was and learning how to better who I was as an artist through messing with cats that I had admired and I knew to trust them with it. And we're in the studio now, working with some stuff with them right now. Yeah.
I'm back with Jam and them?
Yeah, man. I got to do some of that classic with them guys. Man. I can't.
Hold on. I got to give them a little bit, Ralph. I got to give them a little bit of the old. Just give them a little bit of the old school.
That set me all the way up right there. That one set me all the way up for the win right there, man. I got the W with that one.
Did you ever? That thing became the signature song of Ralph Tresvant, boy.
And you believe that was 30 years ago, man?
I can't. I really can't, man. I don't want to believe that.
It's the 30th year anniversary of that song, or that album, man. That's absolutely the meaning to me. I know, man. Oh. If it wasn't for these and this, I probably wouldn't believe it myself, baby.
I know, right? When that thing came out, boy, you had that crispy.
All the way
crispy. You had that little juice up there, boy.
I could have still rocked the shag. I think I might have had it in the video or something. But yeah, back then it was popping. You know what I mean?
Man, speaking of that shag, man, the first New Edition video I saw, what was it? Gosh, man, I think it was Cool It Now. When y'all was on the basketball court.
That's the one.
Boy, that shag was popping. Everybody wanted a shag.
Hey, listen, one of my mans, Method Man, he told me, man, he said, I started rocking the shag because I saw that, you know, how hard body he is. It was crazy to hear him say that. Like, you, like, yeah, man, big Indy fan, man, with you, man, when you was rocking the shag, I had to go get mine done like
that. I'm telling you, boy, you set a lot of trends. And then that mustache game was on point, because when I saw your mustache, man, I almost got jealous because I ain't had one yet. Man, dog, my buddy Corey, he already had his mustache, and his father bought this grease called Excellento back from Germany or something. I was rubbing that stuff up there trying to give me a mustache. I said, you getting me one of them.
No doubt, man. I was steamed during the Cooling Out video. I was already getting a little peach buzz going, to, you know, it was forming. And then they made me shave my joint for the video, man. I was hot.
Yeah, is that what you're talking?
Yeah, they made me shave my joint for the video, man. They put makeup on it afterwards, after they shaved. You can see, like, the little ruffles underneath. I was like, that don't even look natural, man. Look, I got too much upper lip. I had all kinds of confusion. Sure was. But after that, you know, we started grabbing the reins. Like, okay, y'all taking us too far with the colorful rainbow shirts and the weird ties and the London look. It was like, listen, man, we got to go back to the bricks. Y'all finna kill our, y'all get ready to kill our brick. So, yeah, that was after I started letting it come in, and the, you know, the videos after that, we was back to doing what we wanted to do and our vibe.
How long did it take before you could get, like, creative input with the group? Because you was young boys. So I know you was taking a lot of direction from a lot of people.
We did, you know. We was always involved with it, making sure we wrote records. Always, like, I wrote the Ronnie All Coming Down on Me, and started slowly coming in. Ronnie, Bobby, Ricky, and Mike. If I Love the Girl, who cares? You know, I'm in there inking that stuff myself. Started writing songs like Competition on the records, and just letting them know that as far as our clothes, we already knew what we wanted to be like and what we wanted to reflect. We already know what people like as far as we was concerned. We wore our own clothes in the Candy Girl video. That's what we actually wore around the way every day. So it was like, we got to go back to that, man. We don't want to do the colorful, you know, rainbow shirts where everybody got on yellow and pink and orange and royal blue. You know, we want to reflect where we came from, man. So we took over relatively quick. The Cool It Now album, I think going into the Count Me Out album was like, okay, enough is enough. If you look at the Count Me Out clothes, what Michael got on and what Ronnie's rocking, it was Bobby got a tie around his head to try to get some hood in it. It wasn't even a real bandana. No, it was a tie he put on his head to try to get the vibe popping. He's like, man, we got to somehow turn this into us. But right around that album, it was like, okay, enough is enough, man. We shut down. Be doing so. It was probably right around the Company Out album where we really took over and started doing our own creative direction again.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Man, your picture froze up. I'm looking at you. Oh, there you go. What's
going on?
You out there with them boats, man. Them boats, they sucking your Wi-Fi up.
Man, listen, it might be, man. You know, I think I might be, because I'm not far from where my crib is. So I thought I might still have the Wi-Fi on, and it's in between rings, and I'll just cut it off so we'd be back on the regular, my phone network right now. So we'll see. It should be better.
Man, you know what, man? Speaking of clothes, one of the funniest stories that you told me, and I teased Bobby about this, was how he'd be walking around in the hood with that black leather vest on.
In the bricks, man. In middle of August. In the middle of August, he had a full leather suit on. Red pants. He was putting blonde streaks in his hair with Flash. Like, his man was like, his man's was Rick James and Flash. Rick James and Grandmaster Flash. He called himself Flash B. That was his whole thing back then. He was Flash B. And he Candy Girl came out and he lost his mind, man. One of our peoples, Jamie, that we grew up with, used to always come back from New York with all kinds of clothes and sell them to us real cheap, you know, on the low. And right. So we would go to the crib, and she would have all that fly New York gear that everybody was rocking on these, especially like the Furious Five and all them when they be in there posed up with all this stuff on. So that's kind of what he was going for.
Right.
And at mid-August, it could be 100 degrees out. He's going to be outside. We might throw a tank top on, but he still had them leather pants on, rocking the hard body. He wasn't playing.
He was dedicated to it.
Hold on, I got to give you something. Let's reminisce one more time. Yeah, turn that up. That's that old stuff right there. Boy, that's analog recording.
Yeah.
Well, them old synthesizers in that thing. Come on, y'all, get the hearts up. Get the hearts up. This is old school right here. This is what we grew up with. Yeah, come on, Ralph.
Thank you. Man, that key was out of the rafters, man. What key was that? Whoo! That's a funny story about that.
That thing right there, then listen to you talk now. It's totally different.
Listen, when I heard it, I was coming in with it. You know, I haven't sung it in that key in years, or probably even heard it in that key in years from doing it on stage and stuff. We had to lower all that stuff. So when I just heard it, my ears wasn't even registering the key that it jumped to when it came in. Indeed, girl. I was like, oh my God. I understand the story when I played it for my grandmother, my father's mother, for the first time. She heard that tune. I was like, Grandma, what you think? It's all on the radio. Check this out. She's like, yeah, baby, it's so high. I can't listen. It's messing with my ears. It was like it was making her ears. This is what you said to me. And it's hurting my ears. It's so high. I was like, that's my voice. You know, I'm going to get it. You ain't feeling it right there, though.
So you had that little man voice.
Exactly. No more that. I'm the way I'm hitting them noses. You put some vice grips on my niggadies. That's the only way that's happening, man. Other than that, that ain't coming out no more, Kevin.
Not put the vice grips on the niggadies.
Yeah, man. The only way that's coming out, bro. That's
you
come out like that.
Look, you're going to be hitting something else. You put a vice grip on them joints. Oh, man. Oh, that's hilarious, boy. The niggities. Oh, man. Oh, that did it for me right there. I'm using that for the rest of the day. Oh, man.
That's true spit right there, man. Hey, I ain't hitting it no other way. That's the only way it's going to probably come out. You know?
So, look, real quick, man, if anybody has questions for Ralph, you know, I want to give you the opportunity to ask, though. The question box is, like, right next to the comments. If you click them little boxes that got the question mark in it, click that, type your questions in there, and I ask them for you on your behalf, because that's what it's about. One big family affair. Yeah, you're right, G.I. Joe. I'm crying over here. He shouldn't have said that.
I didn't see the question.
How do you spell that, Ralph? How you spell niggities?
How do I spell it? I don't even have a clue, man. It's a feeling thing. I don't think it has a spelling to it. It's just, you got to be able to get these. You just got to be able to say that. It can't even be spelt, man.
Right. All right, let me say. We got one from, how you say that? Sunset in L.A.
Oh, I see. It says, how does he feel about the video?
She must be talking about the new joint, I'm sure.
Loved it. I loved it. I always felt, you know, it was true to what we was going for. When we started doing the video, Director Raid, shout out to him. And when we was trying to do the video, I told him I wanted to capture, because of the feel of the song, I wanted to capture sensitivity 2020, you know, 2020. So sent them that joint. That's what it kind of, the flowy vibe with the ocean watery, the flowy curtains, and, you know, just a smooth grown vibe to it. You know, I wanted to upgrade the drone shots, and I want to cross that. I sent them that video, and I want to cross that with the vibe that we kind of did with the Heartbreak album cover. Got with the cars on the front of the cover, with us standing in front of them. I want to capture that mood with the sensitivity mood and bridge the two, and then bring it to 2020. And when I heard it, when I saw it, that's what I got from it. And that's what I've been hearing from people, too. They said it reminds them of that. So I love the video. And so far, it seems like everybody likes it, too. They like that it's grown, sexy. It's not trying to overdo the whole thing, you know, right, with a bunch of effects to the too much. It's just really letting the song be what it is. And, you know, the muscle cars, we wasn't trying to go for Maybachs and Lamborghinis and, you know, all that kind of stuff. We wanted to bring it to something that we really, truly like. And so we got the muscle cars involved, and it worked out, man. It worked out really good. I really do like the video.
Is that what you like for real? You like muscle cars?
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't have one. You know, that car went back to where we rented it from right after the video, but I'm looking at it because I really like that car. I might mess around and cop that one, but yeah, I've always loved muscle cars. I grew up making model cars, and muscle cars was always the ones I would take to when I was doing models back in the days.
When you made your model cars, did you use the glue, or did you have the ones that snapped together?
Oh, no, you couldn't do the snap, man. That wasn't, man. Come on, man. That's like wearing a wig, you know what I'm saying, and trying to front like that's your head. You know, nah, I'm cool. It's like I got to use the glue, you know. I got to use the glue and the really small parts. You didn't skip bomb. You made sure you put everything on the car that came with the kit. You know what I'm saying? It was like that for me, man.
I used to skip over the little parts. I just wanted to like the.
Had to do it. All do it. No painted parts. I had to, when it was done, you had to paint the parts too. You don't want no parts that's pre-colored and all of that. Nah, that wasn't working for me, man. That wasn't
your joint hard. Have you done one of them since you've been grown? Because I'm sitting here thinking like I should do that again.
It's been a long time. I haven't. I've done puzzles. You know, I've tried to do those. I've done puzzles since I've gotten older, but no models. I actually bought one. What I was doing, me and DeVoe for a minute, was buying the remote control cars you put together, not the pre-made one. We was buying those for a minute, and we raced those around during the, you know, backstage at different tours we was on, stuff like that. But that was one of my things. So for a minute, we did that, but not in a long time. I haven't done an actual mod. I need to do it too. You remember the engine joints?
Yeah. The ones that you put the gas in.
Yeah, when you put the joint together and the engine actually ran afterwards if you did it right.
Yeah.
I never did those neither, but I always wanted to, man. Never got to one. But those are, I was like, man, I got to do an engine. Yeah, but and models used
flown,
to be my
have
thing.
Have you flown a drone before?
No, I haven't. Man, I haven't. You
that right there? Man, them things fun as all know what, boy. I'm gonna show you one I got.
I almost grabbed one day, man. I was at one of them electronic stores and I almost grabbed one.
This is
nice.
One I got.
That's man. They got that's got the camera on it and everything.
Yeah, it got the gimbal and stuff, man. This thing off the chain. I ain't flown in a long time because I hit a tree when I was bringing it down. The second time I flew it.
Uh-huh.
So I was scared. I was looking at it the whole time. You're supposed to take your eyes off of it. You can see it on the screen and see what it's looking at, man. It's off the chain.
Wow. Well, we had some of those.
Good stuff there to do during quarantine right there.
Whew. They had a big, giant one that shot some of the scenes for this video that we're talking about, the All Mine video. They had a pretty huge one. It was black. And I was asking them, inquiring about that. Like, man, you know, where do you get one like this level? But, you know, what was funny about the video and the drone shots is that at the end of the day, we was in the editing room with my people was trying to get it on the phone. Me and Johnny was on the phone from 1 o'clock in the afternoon to 11:30 at night, trying to get the right shots and get the video where the sync and the lips and all of that stuff was best we could get it. But one of the things that happened was all the drone shots pretty much had all the crew in it. They was doing shots with close-ups. Me and Johnny had a camera on Johnny, a camera on me, and the drone above them shooting them and all the shots. So we couldn't use a lot of the drone shots that we had because it had the crew all in all the shots. We couldn't find one without them. There was a couple that ended up being in the ocean, some of the stuff that I was doing on the jetties, on the rocks where I go fishing at. So I was actually, it was actually cool to be able to use some of them, but I really wanted more drone shots in the video. And that's one of the things I do miss overall, but you know, the ones we got, we did find a couple that was able to work and that we, you know, was able to use them. But that drone thing, I was like, how you have all these people on the set with monitors and nobody realizing you got the crew in the shots during the drone shots? Man, come on, man. Got to be more careful.
Right. Got to be more careful. When the album going to come out, rap? Are you still working on the album or you done?
Still working on it, man. Hopefully, you know, we're trying to peak this song, slow walk it, make sure it stays around. We want it to just rise and fall. You know what I'm saying? So the intention is to really move it, keep it up there for a while we work on the project. And hopefully at the peak of it, we'll either be ready to drop the album or definitely be ready to drop another single, and either simultaneously with the second single, drop the album, and or right after the second single movement, come with the album. But if all works, it'll be sometime fall, fall, winter, somewhere around there. Hopefully I could get it out there.
I'll be here waiting on it. All right, here's one. Cooler. Hey, Ralph, congratulations on the new single. How do you maintain your youthful appearance?
Oh, my goodness. Just, you know, I think one of the things is my genes, my mother and father. You know, they were, I guess they're the big contributors to that. But at the end of the day, I just stay active. I eat well. I don't eat crazy. Drink lots of water. I don't party a lot, don't do a lot of things that has to do with, you know, that burns you out too quick and all that kind of stuff. So at the end of the day, it's just making sure you stay healthy as far as your diet. Diet has everything to do with how quick you're going to age, slow, and that extra party and that trying to party too hard to burn you out to give you that old, wrinkled, crazy look, you know.
What kind of stuff you eat, man?
I was vegan for the last 4.5 years. I just started putting seafood and certain things back in my diet just to get certain nutrients back in my system that I wasn't cooking all my own food and stuff. So some of the stuff that I normally would get from my old diet, I was missing to me. And so I started incorporating some of that stuff back into my diet slowly. Okay. So I was more of a pescatarian before I would say just a straight vegan. But being a vegan is hard. I wasn't just a vegan. I was Dr. Sebi vegan. Which on that level, like, you can't even eat certain vegetables and certain fruits that is considered hybrids. It was really tough. Like, it's not just like because you're eating salads and stuff, greens, electric foods all the time, but actually certain electric foods, you know, it was very specific. With that, I did that for a very long time. Most of the vegan diet was a Dr. Sebi diet. Then I started slowly, you know, moving over to a few seafood pieces, maybe some shrimp here, some fish there. But it would be very sparingly and slowly just, you know, some of the things that I would drink, some things like that I started going back to slowly. But overall, it's just got to make sure that you stand on fruits and vegetables. Vegetables primarily as much as possible. I mean, get a lot of that. And if you're going to eat pastas and rices and stuff like that, just make sure they're the right ones. You can't eat that stuff that turns into sugar into your body. Mm. It turns, all the pasta stuff turns. It's just like eating sugar once it's in your body. So be careful of the ones that you do eat. And yeah, you know, that's pretty much my diet overall.
So look, is that how you stay so lean? Does it have any effects on your joints and stuff? Do you still move like you was 12? I get up, I gotta sit on the side of the bed for a minute. So did that diet help you out?
I think that's a big part of it, because I used to have that when I was eating all kinds of meats and fried foods and all that. The fried foods is the ones that's the worst. You can still eat certain meats if you know how to clean your body properly afterwards. Thing is, it's not taking 20 and 30 years of eating that stuff and never properly cleansing it that makes the biggest difference. It starts showing up as you get older. But yeah, for the most part, it's that diet, man. I started noticing when I changed that, started getting more electric foods, live foods that in my body, getting up out of the morning just felt like that groggy thing. You got to kind of work your way out of it. That was gone. It's getting irritated by little things that used to bother you real quick, or you'd be quick to jump on. Hey, why are you doing that with the kids? That that was gone. I was just taking it in. Hey, come here, man. Let me see what you're doing. Didn't I tell you? You know, it's just a whole different type of demeanor. I noticed all of that.
Oh, wow.
It's got to happen. It's the minerals, man. It's really, a lot of people talk about vitamins and all that stuff, but the minerals, that's what's important. Vitamins can't work without the proper minerals. Minerals can work by themselves, but everybody's overemphasizing vitamins, but you got to have those mineral contents. And there's a lot of them that are essential, meaning the body doesn't make them on their own. You got to get them through an external source of some sort. So my relationship with trees and plants became more, became more aware of that, we're really like to have this give and take thing going on with the plant world, you know, from the way we breathe. They breathe in what we breathe out, how they're rooted in the ground with their minerals and the different things that they take to make sure that they don't, you know, they ward off different diseases and bacteria and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. And if you understand it from that perspective, a natural perspective, you start doing those same things. Pretty much the trees are doing, but you know, we gotta put it in. That's why we have a mouth. We gotta feed ourselves these things. The plants are getting that same give and take. The plants is taking it out of the ground, putting it through their leaves and bark and fruits, so we can get it. You know, we can have that exchange with them again. So that's what I learned. When I learned that, you know, it was pretty much uphill for me, man. As far as health, I don't get colds, don't get headaches, little joint pain. I don't get a lot of that stuff. I haven't had them in years. So,
wow.
Yeah, that's been the key to me. I think at the end of the day, realizing that how much we coincide and are doing the same thing plants are doing and just duplicating that.
That's wild, man. That is wild. All right, here's a good question right here. Who do you think was always the best dancer in New Edition?
I came up a Bobby Brown fan. He's dancing. You know, Bobby's is as a dancer, a raw dancer, not needing any choreography, not needing anything to be taught to him, was always the best to me. And I'll still hold that to true this day. As far as Stepper and the Brooke Payne choreography style of dancing, Ronnie would be the best in that one, you know?
Okay, yeah. Hey, Bobby ain't stepping like that no more, though.
Man, Bobby ain't been stepping into the thing a long time. He ain't been stepping his own wild thing on it. It was never like that, the same thing everybody else was doing. He always had to stand out different with how he approached it, so...
Right.
He's a raw.
Hey, I was teasing one day, Ralph. He was in a studio and he performed Ronnie. So he said, "You know what we gonna be doing, right?" And he did them little pump, pump, pump. I said, "Boy, you them pumps got short, boy."
He gonna pump his back out of whack. That's what he gonna do.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Throw them niggities out.
Bobby was more of a cardiovascular thing. He could still do it when he wants to do it, but his workout, his cardiovascular, he just ate that up throughout the years, man. So when we get in rehearsal and we start practicing, we see it come back relatively quickly, too. He starts getting it back in shape, and he starts losing some of his belly, starts slimming back down, looking more like the team, you know what I'm saying? And then when we move around like that, I've seen it happen during the rehearsals, going from rehearsals to the first couple of weeks in tour, stuff like that. The whole group kind of starts looking like a group, like the group again. We start looking similar builds, similar cardiovascular uptake, and being able to keep up with the same regimen. Yeah. But when we first go to rehearsal, man, especially in the later years, it's crazy, man. You wouldn't believe how out of shape some of us are when we walk in that room for the first time. It's crazy.
But you'd be looking like five heartbeats.
I'd be in there looking at him like, y'all better get it together, because I walk in there, I stay ready, so I don't have to get ready. You know?
I need your player.
Yeah, you know. I'm not going in there like that. Brooke always said, no, you know, I'm going to catch it quick. I'm going to catch the routine probably the quickest, one of the quickest, and I'm going to retain it the quickest. I'm going to remember them throughout the rest of the joints. Most of the stuff I learned, and I'm not even doing most of it. But I learn everything everybody knows just in case, you know, I'm out front and I want to jump in the same move with them like Michael used to do. I used to always watch Mike do that with his brothers. He'd be out front doing Mike thing, and out of the blue, he all of a sudden do a move, and you see it's in sync with his brothers. Like, he knew the whole routine in the back of his mind as well. So that was I incorporated that years ago. So I learned the whole routine anyways, even though I'm not really going to be performing most of it. But
yeah,
I learned. Mm-hmm.
That's what's up, man. You're supposed to know, you know? It's great management when you know everything that everybody knows. Exactly. And you can always step in place. So we got to talk about the new song, because we run out of time. Talk about how you ended up doing this particular song, All Mine.
Which one?
All Mine, the new song.
How'd I do that? Actually, that was a song I've been, that's a song that was submitted for Johnny.
Yeah.
It was supposed to, it, that he was about to do on his project, or was submitted for his project. And when he heard the song, he said that he told me that he had told him that, man, this sounds like my brother. And so he got me on the phone, said, I got something I want you to hear. And he sent it over to me. I immediately heard the song and felt that, what he meant. Like, that sounds like a song I would sing easily. You know, that I send my register, send my range, and send my kind of, you know, my demeanor, my swag, how I move, how I sing. So I went over to his house, cut the song at his home studio, about 3 or 4 hours. I left out of there. About 2 or 3 days later, he sent the track back to me with him and my vocal slightly mixed. I think that's the one you probably heard.
Yeah.
And I said, okay, it sounds like that JGRT, you know, magic. It sounds like one of those joints. Because we had just came out the perfect song.
Right, right,
and
right.
But he was singing the lead, and I came and featured on his hook. And so when I heard him back on this joint here, which wasn't the plan, but it ended up being that way, it's like, this is a perfect joint to set it all off with. Especially because that one did so well, and while that energy's out there,
yeah,
I will keep it rolling while that's working right now. And that's how we came up with this one. And it just, it's one of those songs that felt like a nice bridge of then and now. It mm-hmm. still feels fresh enough to be something that could win now, not too dated, but not trying to chase being young and what the youngsters right. are doing, trying to do that either. So that's how we picked this one and said, all right, this is a winner for us. Let's go for it.
Yeah, that's a good one here, man. Let me play a little bit of that one.
Mm-hmm.
Donnie, I said you had to put your
racket on. Yes, sir.
Hey, that's another classic right there, boy.
Man, it took 30 years to put out another one, man. They're crazy.
That's another classic. I be teasing Boogie all the time. I said, why you had to put your raggedy behind on there? You couldn't just let Ralph shine by itself.
Man, it was perfect. Like I said, coming off of the other one, perfect, no pun intended. It just felt right, you know?
Yeah.
It just felt like, yeah. Plus, when Skeleton came to me, man, that, you know, this was one of those things he wanted to make sure I did. Johnny is the one who really pushed me and got me out the couch. Like, come on, man. You got to stop. Get practicing. You know, I watched him do his thing and get his turnkey situation where he puts out his own records on his own label, his own team, fine-tune that. I watched him take some wins. I watched him take some L's, fine-tune it to where he got it with. Now it's been working consistently. He said, man, come on over here. Let's do it together. We put together, you helped sign my thing to his thing. So it was a joint venture. We found us some distribution, and here we are, making it work.
But you know what, Ralph, to that point, man, that's what it takes sometimes, you know, and sometimes we kind of fall in a slump and we need somebody to motivate us and push us a little bit. And, you know, that's what brotherhood is all about, you know, and you guys have created some great records together.
That's right, man. In the industry, was it changed so much? It's like, who do you trust? I know I can trust my brother. I know when he says he's going to do what he's going to do, he's really going to do it. He's going to at least give it his best shot. So it's best to stop right there than anywhere else. You know, you got to worry about them putting you up with a bunch of other cats, throwing you up against the wall with them and see what sticks kind of thing. Now, Johnny's, we're going to make sure we do what we're supposed to do. And so it made it easy for me to do what I have to do. All the promotion, all the studio time, whatever it's going to take. I'm willing. I know where, at the end of the day, where that's going to go. It's not going to be in vain. We're really going to give it a shot. And that's why you see what's going on right now. The noise is being made because the team that we joined, forces that we put ourselves against or with, up with, and or joined, aligned ourselves with, and his team is great. It's all family, people we already know.
Yeah.
That I know what they want. They want to see it win. They want to see me win. They want to see Johnny win. So that's what makes sense. Instead of going to somebody who don't know nothing about us, who we don't know if they're serious, or if they just going, you know, just blow a bunch of smoke, but not really follow through with it, you know, what they're saying.
Right.
JG put his money where his mouth is. He put his time where his mouth is. Put his team, and believed in what, you know, there's still room out there. Johnny goes far as saying, man, just come over here and do what I'm doing, man. I was like, yeah, I got no problem with that. I already know. Plus, he was on the thing. Like, I'm winning. I'm doing my thing. I, you know, still winning. Game changer 1-2.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, why not? You know, it makes more sense to go over there with somebody that you trust and you love and give it a shot over there. Man, and plus the way he brought me in as an equal partner on everything. It's like, come on, man. Make sure this is right.
Yeah, you know, man, I tell Johnny all the time, man, he a solid guy.
Man,
you don't find people like that too often, but you know, I can actually say he is a genuine friend and brother. If I call on him for something, he'd be right there to do it, man.
That's right. You better know that.
Yeah.
Real dude, man. Hey, listen, nobody better not ever mess with Johnny Gill. They got to go through me too. It's going down just like that. Love him to death. That's my big bro, man.
Hey, man, you know what? You know, and to think the way your relationship formed with Johnny, it was almost like you guys were supposed to be against each other. And look how you have bonded and the things that you've been able to accomplish just out of friendship and the bond and being a brother to each other.
Yeah, man. That's exactly how it came off. When it first went down, it was almost like we was being pit against each other some sort of way. And, you know, what's meant for evil, God would always flip it. He's going to always turn into his, you know, he's going to get the glory at the end of the day, man. So that's how I see it. That the Almighty Creator got a plan, and we all don't have any clue what it is until you just got to play your role, play your part. I met Johnny, and we've been this tight ever since.
Mm-hmm.
You know, back in that room, and he asked me, what have I got myself into? And I said, welcome to New Edition, man. We've been like this ever since. We see the same. We see the industry the same way. We see the our personal lives on and off the court, to use an analogy, in and out of the studio, on and off stages, in and out of the industry. We see the world the same way. It's very easy, very comfortable. I mean, we talk about stuff that don't have nothing to do with the music industry most of the time. You know, I'll pick up on him, his son, his mom. You know, he does the same to me. Genuine concern about what's going on in my personal life.
Yeah.
And that makes all the difference in the world to me, man. You know, that's when I know you're a real friend. And I've seen Johnny not do this for me. I've seen him do this for everybody.
Yeah.
I've seen him do this for everybody that he knows is close to him. It goes far beyond what most people would do, man. Far beyond. I want people to know that about him. As I'm moving around, they're going to definitely understand how I feel about him.
Absolutely.
So what, right now, I don't even know if I'd be doing what I'm doing right now. I really don't know.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So we got another question here. What can you tell the next generation about coming up in the world we live in today?
Oh, my God. Coming up in the world we live today, that's very hard. It's so unpredictable. Like, I don't know that, you know, what to do next right now. It's like all of us are just kind of winging it. But I would say stay close to your family.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're close ones you love, make that the most important thing for you, man. All this trying to go be like Mike and trying to be like the next, you know, Chris Brown or Jeezy or Beyonce, whatever. I mean, all of that stuff is cool. But just stay grounded in family as the most important thing in your world, man. Because after it's all said and done, even if you reach those type of heights, which most people rarely do, but even if you, it's always going to come back down to when they close that casket for the last time, those ones that was really around you, your blood is going to be the ones who was really there, who really understood you, who really cared, who was going to, even if it don't work, going to feed you, make sure you got a roof over your head and all that kind of stuff. That's where that's gonna stay grounded and rooted in your fam, bam, man, first, and then go for your dreams. with them in mind, with them in terms of their plight, what they're going through, and some of the motivation of why you want to succeed. Not to have your own Maybox and ships and mansions and all that, but to lift your people. Yep. That's going to be your biggest motivation at the end of the day. And that'll never go away. There's always going to be, that's always going to be there as a motivation. And you'll never look at it in vain later on. Like, why did I, you know, why did I use that as motivation? That'll never die. The family motivation, that family reasoning for why you want success, to help lift and be there for them. There's nothing else will compare to that at the end of the day. So keep family in your mind as your motivation, man.
Well spoken, man. And that's a wrap right there, boy. We got 1 minute left, so I just want to say thank you. And for everybody that's meeting me for the first time tonight, be sure to follow me here at Kamen Kelly, because I got friends like Ralph Tresvant. I'm trying to tell you, this is my man. I know people.
That's for life, man. Like I said before, I appreciate you. You already know.
Yes, sir. That's what
I'm saying, man, to the END. I'm always going to love me some Kamen Kelly. If you need me for whatever, bro, you just let me know. I'll be on the first thing smoking.
No doubt. I appreciate you, man, and love to you, and thanks for joining me tonight. Rizz.
Rider, stand up on it, and thanks for joining us today, man. This is always hot to me when I blend with my man. You know, we go so far back, I always know it's going to be fun, it's going to be real. So thanks for joining us today, and lighten up those lines and stuff for us, man.
Yes, sir. And everybody, thank you, and have a great night. Take care of yourselves. One love, family. Peace.
One love.